In this video, we're going to talk about Hilbert spaces. Now, a Hilbert space is a vector space with an inner product such that we can use the topology of the vector space is based on the inner product. Now, this is a lot of fancy words, and if the vector space is finite dimensional, there's really nothing that you need to do. There's only one topology that you can put on Rn. But for infinite dimensional vector spaces, there is something to it. So the idea is, if we've got a sequence of vectors, we want to be able to say what it means for the sequence to converge, and what it means to take limits. That's what topology tells us. And the idea is that we're going to use the notion of length that comes from the inner product to tell us what convergence means. So if I say that the limit of a bunch of vectors is another vector, what I'm really saying is that the distance between these vectors is getting less and less and less. So the distance between these is going to zero, and that means that the inner product of y minus xn with itself has to be going to zero. So if this inner product goes to zero, then we say that it converges. Now, once we know what convergence means, we know how to take infinite sums. Because just like with numbers, an infinite sum is by definition the limit of a finite sum as you take more and more and more terms. When we don't know how to add up an infinite number of numbers or an infinite number of vectors, but we know how to add up n vectors and then see what happens as we take more and more and more and more terms. So an infinite sum is by definition the limit of a finite sum, and limit is defined by the inner product. Okay, so these sums make sense as long as the terms are getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller fast enough, just like a series involving numbers. Now, if I give you a Hilbert space, you want to have a basis for it. And when we say basis, we mean something slightly different than we're used to. See, we're used to a basis being a set of vectors that's linearly independent and spans the space. And by span, we mean take finite linear combinations. Only now we're going to allow infinite linear combinations. We want every vector in the space to be written at, to be decomposable as an infinite linear combination of the basis vectors. And we want the only way to get zero as an infinite linear combination is by making all the coefficients being zero. So this is just like the definition that we have for linear independence that we're used to, except we're allowing infinite combinations. And this is the definition that we're used to for spanning, only we're allowing infinite linear combinations. So that's a lot of definitions. Let's take a look at some examples of Hilbert spaces. One example is called little L2, L sub 2, we call it L2. And this is the set of all sequences. You should think of this as being an infinite dimensional space where we got the one direction, the two direction, the three direction. And the length of a vector is just the square root of a1 squared plus a2 squared plus a3 squared plus a4 squared plus a5 squared and so on. So we want the sum of ai squared to converge. So it's all sequences whose terms get small enough fast enough that this converges. We call them square summable. And the inner product of two sequences is going to be a1 bar times b1 plus a2 bar times b2 plus a3 bar times b3 plus a4 bar times b4 and so on. This is just like the inner product we would have for cn. See, if we stopped our sequences after n terms, a list of n numbers is an element of cn. But our lists go on forever. It's like cn, but as n goes to infinity. That's an example of a Hilbert space. Another example is called big L2. You use the capital L instead of lowercase, and you write it as a superscript, not a subscript. And that's functions. It's functions on the real line that are square integrable instead of square summable. All functions that if you square them, integrate them from minus infinity to infinity, you get a finite number. And for this, we want the inner product to be the integral of the first guy conjugate times the second guy, because we're going to allow complex valued functions. If you're looking at real valued functions, that's just f of t times g of t. And this is the space that comes up all the time in quantum mechanics. The wave functions of a particle live in L2 of the real line. One-dimensional quantum mechanics. Okay, the third example is you can take L2 not of the entire line, but of just the interval from A to B. So they're going to be functions that you square them and integrate them from A to B, you get something finite. And then the inner product is going to be the integral of f bar times g from A to B. So for each of these three examples, let's take a look at what the basis should be. The basis for little L2, we said that little L2 looked like just ordinary n-dimensional space, but as n goes to infinity. And the basis is going to be the same thing. We have E1 is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So it's 1 in the first direction and 0 in all the other directions. And E2 is 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And E3 is 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. And in general, EJ is going to be a sequence that has a 1 in the jth slot and a 0 in all the other slots. This is the analog of the unit vector pointing in the jth direction that we have in Rn. And if you have any old vector, you can write it as x1 e1 plus x2 e2 plus x3 e3 and so on. And the point is, if you do the sum and you cut it off after n terms, then what's left is small. The sum of the remaining coefficients is very small, and we win. Second example is for L2 of R, if you take polynomials times e to the minus t squared over 2. So 1 times e to the minus t squared over 2, t times e to the minus t squared over 2, t squared times e to the minus t squared over 2, t to the j times e to the minus t squared over 2. This is not an orthogonal basis. This was an orthogonal basis, orthonormal actually. This isn't an orthogonal basis, but it is a basis. Now, showing that's a basis is not easy. You have to do some calculations involving quantum mechanics. I'm not going there. Finally, we have L2 of an interval, and we're going to make the interval from 0 to L instead of from A to B. If you look at the function sine of pi t over L, that's a function that starts off at 0, goes up, and then by the time that you reach L, you get sine of pi, which is 0 again. And then another function is sine of 2 pi over t. And then you have sine of 3 pi over t, and sine of 4 pi over t. And here's a picture of sine of 7 pi over t. 7 pi t over L. Sine of pi t over L, 2 pi t over L, 7 pi t over L. These functions turn out to form an orthogonal basis for this space. And the whole act of decomposing things in that basis is called Fourier series. And we're going to see how to do that in our next video.